Docker is a very prominent container solution. It's widely used in software development and deployment because essentially you can create a whole system and easily run it anywhere that supports such a container. You can somewhat imagine containers like a VM, at least from the point of view of a regular user, but in reality it's very much not a VM. The differences are very technical, but I want to ignore that for now. Though, if you know me, of course we will look at the important differences between a VM and a container too, just not now. Let's first check out how Docker containers are very useful for CTFs and why they are awesome for IT security work in general. At the Real World CTF in 2018, there was this challenge, Flag Lab. I made a video about that and you can find the link below. The challenge gave us a file to download, which turned out to be a Docker Compose YAML config file. This config file basically described the setup of a Linux machine with a specific GitLab version, and we were able to simply use the command docker compose up to run it locally. I didn't have to compile anything, I didn't have to install any dependencies for GitLab, I didn't have to make sure nothing else interferes with it, I simply just had to use docker compose up. And then I had magically a local GitLab instance running, ready for me to test with. This is awesome for CTF players, because we can focus on searching for the vulnerability instead of dealing with the setups. And also, when you made an exploit that works locally, it should easily work on the actual challenge server, because the organizers likely used the same Docker Compose config to run the challenge. This is obviously also awesome for bug bounty hunters looking for bugs in GitLab, because they can quickly get easy local setup to test with. It's just easy and comfortable. But besides running and hosting challenges with Docker, you can also use Docker to set up your CTF play environment. I played CTFs with various different setups in the past. Either directly on my Mac or Linux laptop, renting a Linux machine to SSH into it, setting up a Linux VM, or also using Vagrant to manage VMs from the command line easily. However, over the past 1 to 2 years, I'm using Docker more often. Basically, I'm using Docker on my Mac or on a rented Linux machine to quickly set up tools. You basically use Docker like a Linux server where you SSH into. You have a shell and tools installed, so no graphical user interface. It's used for running command line tools and execute scripts that you write during the CTF. And so now that you got a quick introduction how it can be used, let's set it up and do some examples. Setup is actually super easy, but it's different on Windows, Linux, or Mac. It's important to understand that Docker uses features by the Linux kernel called namespaces to create something what we call a container. So Docker runs on Linux, which means when you use Docker on Windows or Mac, in fact, you are running a hidden Linux VM and Docker is then using that. But the Docker desktop tools for Mac and Windows make that easy and it mostly should just work. Getting it on your own Linux desktop should also be easy, or you rent a Linux server from, example, DigitalOcean. Let's chill for a moment with my referral link here. You should even get a $100 credit. I use DigitalOcean all the time because I'm lazy to set up a VM. Also because it's a server, you get a public IP and that can be very useful for CTFs or other stuff too. AWS, Azure, or Google Cloud works great too. I just happen to use DigitalOcean. Anyway, to install Docker, just follow these steps here in the Docker help. Copy and paste those commands. I don't need to show and explain how to do Ctrl-C and Ctrl-V, you can figure that out. But besides Docker itself, you might want to install Docker Compose too. There are steps describing how to do that in the Docker docs as well. To summarize, Docker gives you command line tools to start and configure individual containers. Docker Compose uses Docker to give you some commands to launch multiple containers, describing a whole setup with multiple systems. So let's do an example. When you go to my GitHub, you can find a pwn Docker example. It serves basically as an example how a pwnable CTF challenge could look like in a CTF. Feel free to grab it and try to develop an exploit for it. If you solve it, tell me about it. So clone that repository and have a look at the challenge folder. You can find the Docker file, that's the regular Docker config file. A test flag, the system health check C source code, as well as the compiled challenge binary, and ynetd. That's a small tool to create a simple server that runs the CTF binary when somebody connects to the port via netkit. Anyway, with docker build dot, you can build the Docker container as described in the Docker file. I also use -t to give this container a name. I call it like the name of the challenge. Let's have a quick look at the Docker file. You can see it's based on an Ubuntu version 19.10 image, so that's the base image that is used. There's a whole Docker repository with all the images you can imagine. Ubuntu is one such repository. Then we specify the commands that should be run within this container. We want apt-get update, add a CTF user, set the work dir to that user's home directory, copy the challenge binary, the test flag, and ynetd server into the container. So copy from the local system into the current working directory of the container, change permissions of the home folder, switch to the CTF user, and then execute the command ynetd to start the server on port 1024, and the server should execute the binary. And when you type the build command, you can exactly see that happened. And this now built a Docker image, an image of a container we could start anytime. With Docker images, you can see all the images you have locally available, and here's ours. Now we can run that image with Docker run. I'm using here minus D to run it in detached mode, so the container simply runs in the background. I use minus P to map a port from within this container to a port on my host machine. Very important if you want to run any kind of server in the container. RM to automatically remove the container when we exit the container, and minus IT, which is keep stdin open and allocate a tty. Now that I think about this, that's actually useless in this case. I guess it's just a habit that I do that. It's important when you execute just command line tools and you want to use it like a shell. Anyway, there we go. It's running now. With Docker PS, you can see the container running here. It shows the command we executed, ynetd, as well as the port we mapped from inside the container to our host machine. And now we can simply use netcat on our host to connect to localhost on port 1024, because we mapped the port from inside the container to our machine. And now you have the challenge running locally for testing, and you could develop your exploit for it. Awesome easy setup and deployment. Now the other side. Now let's use Docker as a CTF player environment. I have also linked you an example shitty Docker file I'm using. It's not thought out, it's not meant to be the most awesome environment for CTF, it's just me using it and sometimes adding new tools to it. I actually encourage you to start your own file and add whatever you need when you need it, but feel free to just use it too. This one we also put into a folder and built an image from it. I call it CTF and tag it with Ubuntu 19.10. That's just the name I give it because that's what it's based on. Now you can see I'm just installing here various kinds of tools that you might need. It can take quite a while in this case, but eventually you can start this image with Docker run. I'm doing this again detached, remove the container when done, but very important is minus V. It's mounting volumes, so storage of folders from our host system into the container. You can see that I'm using the shell variable pwd, which is the current working directory, which means my challenge folder here will be accessible inside the container in /pwd. You see why that is useful soon. Then we are adding the ptrace capability as well as disabling seccomp. Both are important Linux features to restrict processes, so we basically disable security features, but we need that if we want to use GDB for debugging programs. Ptrace is a syscall in Linux to debug another process, so GDB needs that, and seccomp would prevent GDB from disabling ASLR during debugging, which is also very useful. So you are disabling some security settings, but I mean, in this context, it doesn't matter, who cares? It's running now. So with Docker PS, we can see this container running here. And now, magic. We can use docker exec to execute a process within this container, and we want to execute bin bash, because that gives us a shell. And this is the container ID where we want to run this in. And now you can see here the minus IT, which is actually important now, because now we want to have this interactive keyword input shell. It looks and feels like you just SSH'd into a server. But obviously you haven't, you're just now running bin bash in that container. Anyway, when you go to /pwd, you can now see the files from the challenge folder. I will call this container now the CTF container, and the previous container we started with the challenge I will call challenge container, and both of them run on my host system, just so there's no confusion. Remember that on the challenge container we exposed the port 1024 to our host system, which means when we get the IP of our host system, in this case it's on my local network 192.168.112.129, we can use netcat from within our CTF container to connect to that port too. So now we can run or develop our exploit within the CTF container. On a Linux setup, this might not make much sense, but on a Mac setup, this is an easy way for me to get a Linux environment to run stuff. So now I could create a Python script in the challenge folder and use, for example, pwn tools, the awesome Python module, to connect to the challenge server and read the response. and then I can execute that within my container. Opening connection, and there's the response. I think this is really awesome because I didn't have to install or fiddle with PwnTools dependencies or setups at all, because everything was nicely set up already in the container. Because this is now Linux, I also have no issues to run the binary as a process in the CTF container too, even use GDB. So let's debug quickly this binary because it asks for a password. This is the basic example challenge. The password is also in the source. I'm just showing off the process a bit. Anyway, here's the string compare, and so that seems to be the secret password. Going back to my host machine, continue developing the exploit script, adding the send line to send the password, and also change the code from the remote target to a local process target. So we developed that code on the host machine in our IDE and can now go to our CTF container shell and execute it. Now, instead of connecting to the remote server, we run the binary locally as a process. I mean, whatever, this is not a Python PwnTools tutorial, but you get the point, it's convenient. Next video will be about how Docker containers actually work. And if you want to have a small sneak peek, rewatch this video and replace every time when I say the word container with the word namespace.